Welcome to Brain Software Podcast, episode 127. I'm your co-host, Chris Thompson. Today, Mike and I will be discussing a ton of stuff, from hypnotic manipulation to hypnotic language and much, much more. So stay tuned, because the hypnotic storm is about to engulf you.
It was the most remarkable thing. I wound up saying to the chap, "There's the trouble with you damn people. No matter how much you learn and no matter how much you earn, or even if you're wearing a nice suit, you can always get enough caviar, but you never get enough toast to go with it. Anyway, it's not really caviar, just some tiny bits of black paper sprayed with vinegar."
You are correct, and it's not toast either. More like carefully sliced brown paper, warmed over a fire and dipped in vinegar.
This is so true, Mr. Thompson. Too damn true. But you know what I really want to know? Whatever happened to that old tranquility we used to know?
These are days of victory! So let's begin by welcoming the living, breathing Hypnoticon. A man who's got his energy back after days of hard work. A man who loves cats more than you love food. The world's foremost fan of Captain Sensible, Mike Mandel!
Yes, Chris. Captain, I said what?
I said what? I love that song. All right. Well, welcome to the Hypnotic World Epicenter, Mike. And we are here with another awesome podcast.
We've got a ton of stuff. Let's do a quick debrief. We've had some amazing things happening in our live trainings lately.
Yeah, so we are recording this on whatever day. May 21st is when we're recording it, so it won't go live until later in May. But we have just finished two wonderful trainings. One was with Freddie and Anthony Jacquin. We brought them in from the UK, and they did an amazing job.
Unbelievable.
And I'll be very busy doing all the slicing and dicing on the videos, which is going to be fun. And then we did our 5-day May Architecture of Hypnosis training, which was pretty awesome.
Chris, yeah, I heard from like three people. I just interrupted you, but in our proper way.
Yeah.
I heard from like three people saying, including one of our doctors, saying it was just a life-transforming, a life-changing experience.
Yeah, it's a strange thing, right? If you come to a hypnosis training, you figure you're just going to learn how to do hypnosis. But what ends up happening with our trainings is people get a whole lot more.
New friends. And we had that awesome girl, Haley, came all the way from Alaska
our first ever from Alaska, which is really cool.
We had Belgium, Britain.
And I think we had five medical doctors in the class and five Australians, which was pretty cool.
Unbelievable.
So quite a fun experience. Come on out to Toronto, MikeMandelHypnosis.com/events, and you can check out the calendar. By the time this goes live, there is a possibility that there may be spots for our June class, which runs
a few, not many.
June 24 to 28. It's almost sold out now, but depending on how things go, you know, it's a summer season. People are slowing down a bit. I don't know. If you want to find out, go to the events page on our website, and if you can make it to Toronto for the June class, you can always email me and ask if we happen to have any cancellations or anything. And if there are, I'll let you in. And otherwise, we'll be doing a class in November. But check it out on our website. And
now let's talk about the Jacquins for a minute, because they both brought just stellar quality to Toronto, and people were just blown away. They are on all the time. And let's talk about Freddie first. Here is a guy. You would think he had come up with the Mandel triangle of confidence, congruence, and intention, because the man is, he's my age, he's immensely charismatic. He's a very powerful personality, and people are just drawn to him like moths to a flame. And his confidence and his congruence, when he brings someone up to do an intervention, there is not one speck of doubt that it's going to work exactly the way he plans. It's amazing, isn't it?
It's fantastic. They did such a great job. Freddie and Anthony were just a really great team, and I'm very excited to get the videos from that training out to the world.
Yeah, for sure, man. And Anthony is another excellent trainer, and the guy is a you know, magic brain box. I call him Jack the Lad, which is
Jack the Lad.
Oh, I think he's Jack the Lad. Anthony is Jack the Lad.
He is.
And you know, you want to discuss his whole thing about when he's doing hypnosis and teaching objective response versus subjective response and how that applies.
Yeah, you want to get into that right
now? Yeah, I think it's interesting stuff.
Yeah, so he was one of the first things that he talked about on the Saturday morning when he was discussing with the class, what is hypnosis and what are we looking for as hypnotists and our clients? And he really hammered on this idea that we're looking for people to not just have some sort of objective response. Like if you're doing a magnetic fingers suggestibility test, right, for example, or you can use that as an induction too, as most of our students know. And if you don't know what magnetic fingers is, that's fine. You don't worry about it. But it's an exercise that you're doing with someone where their fingers are going to move together. And Anthony's pointing out clearly that we don't just want the objective response that, oh, the person's fingers move together.
Right.
We're looking for this subjective response in the person that, whoa, something's just happening.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
This is why calibration is so important. And we've talked about it a lot on this podcast. And of course, we talk about it in our classroom a lot. It's really important to calibrate who you're talking to, what kind of response you're getting. We've talked, was it last time? I think we talked about body language and people's feet pointing away from you. They're trying to get away from the conversation.
That was a couple ago. But it's a good point. Mm-hmm. You have to be calibrating. And when you give the person an experience, they have that subjective response, which is an immensely powerful thing. What I found interesting, too, about their training was the way Freddie just automatically goes to the Jacquin power lift, the induction he invented. And I said in our class, although I didn't teach it this time around, I always credit, you know, we always credit whoever we learn from. But the Jacquin power lift, to me, like the Dave Ellman induction, they're the only two I've said are, other than the ones, of course, I've come up with myself. But for the inductions that are out there, it's immensely powerful to the point of being perfect.
It is. You and just don't mess with it.
It's
do
quick,
it the
easy.
Way
it
it's
works.
Taught.
Yeah, it's brilliant. Yeah. Brilliant.
So if you ever get the chance to learn the Jacquin power lift from Freddie or Anthony, just learn it and do it the way it's taught. Don't mess with it. Don't think I'm going to improve upon it
you
in
can't.
This way.
Yeah.
It's fantastic. And in fact, it was taught quite clearly in the videos on the course.
Nice,
so they
nice.
Will be available on our website. And with that, what else do you want to move on to?
Well, I want to talk about that interesting email we got where someone said about our podcast, how obnoxious the beginning was.
Yeah, so Friday.
We're laughing so you can tell we haven't repented.
It was Friday morning, May 17th.
Approximately,
and
In
our classroom, I went to the back where I had my computer and I, while you were teaching, and I hit the publish button on episode 122.
And within minutes.
Yeah, so somebody wrote back and just, it was quite funny because, you know, whoever wrote back, they must not be following very closely.
Right.
But the person wrote back and said, you know, this podcast was just horrible. You'll never make it in hypnosis
if you're so obnoxious. Yeah, you'll never make it in hypnosis.
I just like, thanks, Mike. I guess we'll never make it in hypnosis.
So what was your response to this person?
I just deleted the person from our email list.
But I thought you answered.
Oh, I did. I just wrote back. And
Newsflash,
we already have. Now, obviously, I didn't say that because we want to toot our own horns or anything.
But you did.
We're doing a great job, I think, of attracting excellent people to come to Toronto listen to this podcast,
five medical
take
doctors.
Our online training. I think we're doing a pretty good job. And
you've just
I thought
gone
that
from
was,
great to pretty good. I thought pretty
that
soon
was,
you'll be apologizing.
I thought that was pretty funny that we got that email. So
well, you know, I think it's because of all the crazy stuff we put on, but I am absolutely unrepentant for the simple reason that I'm closer to 70 than 60. The podcast gives me an outlet for my own ridiculous sense
things
of humor.
Things have to be fun.
I like context-free humor. Chris likes it too. He's gotten really good at it. And, you know, Michael C. Anthony, our awesome friend who was just over for the weekend, stayed at my place. He used to do a thing, drove his wife nuts. It's the same sort of thing. Stupid humor over and over and over. She'd get so mad at him, she'd say, it's not funny anymore. And his answer was, still funny to me.
Mike, okay, let me throw in a... let me throw in a quick story here to make this point
clear. Okay, go ahead,
clear.
Ken.
So this is the one-minute metaphor. A few years ago, I started doing gymnastic strength training, and one of the things that I had to do was buy a pair of gymnastic rings. This is just a piece of workout equipment, and I'd been using them to get stronger. Well, the other day, so specifically on the weekend, after the architecture of hypnosis was over, my kids were out at a dance competition pretty much the entire weekend. So on one day, I put the gymnastic rings up in my backyard where I've never hung them before, but I just wanted to have something to get some physical exercise because I wanted to break up my day where I was otherwise just editing videos. Oh, I was slicing and dicing all the Wizard School videos that we'd shot. And I wanted to be able to step away from my computer and get some exercise. Well, I left the rings up. And when the kids got home from the dance competition, they immediately noticed them. My youngest daughter specifically, she went over and she started doing some exercises on them. But it didn't take her more than about 15 or 20 seconds, Mike, before she realized that rings could be swings, and so she could swing on them and have a lot of fun. And it occurred to me that sometimes it's just the children who remember how much fun it is to have fun. And sometimes us adults can take a cue from a kid and remember to have a good time and just have fun and laugh.
Well, I feel chided. And I'm not sure how to take that.
That's brilliant, buddy. Brilliant. All right.
All right, where are we going next?
We're going to talk about hypnosis and manipulation.
All right. This is a topic I want to talk about.
This comes up all the time, man. All the freaking time.
Right. And actually, did we talk about this metaphor that I said, you know, a hammer can be manipulative? You can manipulate a nail.
Or you can manipulate a skull.
You could manipulate a skull. You know, yeah, a knife could be used to cut your steak. A knife could be used to hurt somebody, right? So this idea that something is manipulative
by its very nature
is we looked up the definition before this podcast of what manipulation means, and I can't remember what. Are you going to pull it up right now?
I can't remember
now?
Anything about it.
Okay, so
I'm going to get it for you, buddy.
It all comes down to intent, though. While you're looking for the definition, we'll just keep talking. So if you are manipulative, it implies that you're doing it in such a way to only benefit yourself.
Well, it's saying to control or play upon by artful, unfair, or insidious means for one's own advantage.
Okay.
So you're controlling, you're doing something to change someone else's behavior entirely for your own advantage.
Okay. So then we can back up and say all communication is intended to evoke some sort of a reaction,
response. I'll say response.
Yeah, response. And those responses can be for one's own gain or to help another person, right? So, but if we just generalize and go, well, manipulate is to change in some way, right? I can manipulate
To get a response or a change of behavior in the other person. But what about something, Chris, like you know, pickup artists, the guys who were gaming women and stuff. Like, that to me is manipulation.
To me, yeah, and that's
the thing. Because the intention is seduction.
That's it.
And
every time that we look at this, we have to think about intent. What is it that you're trying to accomplish? What is it that you're hoping to accomplish?
Right.
And if you're after tricking somebody to give you money, to do something for you, or in the case of a pickup artist, yeah, to do something.
To hook up, yeah.
Exactly. That is definitely in line with the definition of manipulation.
I would say it is.
Whereas hypnosis is a form of communication, and all communication can be manipulative, but that doesn't mean that all communication is manipulative.
That's right. And when you said hypnosis is a form of communication, Chris and I tend to see hypnosis as very, very powerful communication, but also an amplifier of human experience.
Right.
If you see it as an amplifier, then anything you're doing with hypnosis is an amplification, whether it's playing guitar, running in a race, having sex with somebody. You know, hypnosis, it's an amplifier of experience.
Yeah.
But what this makes me think of is when you know, we watch Freddie Jacquin work with people in front of the group, just cold. And when he was bringing in a transformation with someone, he would say, now, see the face of the people who you love most in the world.
Yeah, he always brought that
out. It might be your pet, you know, might be your wife, might be your son. But see the face of someone who, you know, feel the love from them. Because his thing, which is amazing, he says, create an emotion, give a suggestion.
Right.
And he builds in these feelings of love and so on, and then starts piling in all this victorious change, which is very clever. Now, is that manipulation?
Well, not when the intent, according to the dictionary definition, not when the intent is to help the other person.
That's right.
But if you throw that part away and you say manipulation is just for my words to create some sort of change in the other person, and we don't think about the intent, then yes, it would be manipulative.
Right.
Like, but it would be the good kind of manipulation. I think we need a definition.
What's the end result down that, you know, you could say, oh, I seduced this girl. I used all these embedded commands and all these techniques to get some woman in bed. Oh, and she really enjoyed it, so the end result is okay. I don't think you can say that, because
I wouldn't go that far.
No, neither would I. No, neither would I.
I think that if somebody comes to you and says, well, look, I've got this phobic response to ladders. I don't know.
Yeah.
Purple paint. Yeah. I've got a phobic response to purple painted ladders.
Yeah.
Okay, I can help you with that. Would you like help with that? Yes, I would. All right. Now we have... It's not manipulation. What is a good word we should replace this word manipulation with? The kind of influence, the kind of change that we help somebody else accomplish that they want. Because you could call that hypnosis.
It's a good question. It's hypnosis, right? Like if I say, if someone has a phobia of purple ladders with cottage cheese on them or whatever, a very specific phobia, and I say to the person who's in a trance, and look over there and see another you who has shaken off this phobia, and look at him climbing that ladder, and he's smiling and he's happy, and how would you like to be that person instead? Now, I'm using hypnosis to lead the person to a place where they are now willing and ready to let go of this phobic response that served them in the past to protect them. Now, is it manipulation? Well, my intention is to give them a happier life.
Right.
You know, so, and a better life. So I think it's a danger of saying anything is just this. You know, again, we're always back to, is it intended to help? Is it intended to harm?
Yeah.
And the end result is going to make it very clear. It's interesting, Chris. It reminds me of some of the mentalism stuff I did over the years. I did one thing at a church youth group years ago, and the minister came over. He's serious with me. How did you do that? You tell me how you did that. You're reading that person's mind. I said, no, I'm not. I said, it's called an effect. You tell me how it's done. I said, no. I said, I'm not going to betray my profession for anybody.
Yeah.
I didn't say what I wanted to say. It's just that people are ignorant. You know, they're operating within their own perceptual filters.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to be willing to look at things.
So that brings up the idea that let's say somebody sees a Facebook ad or reads one of our blog posts talking about something like our hypnotic language cards,
right,
for example, which are aimed at helping people learn to use hypnotic language in everyday conversation to be more persuasive, to be more helpful. And I mean persuasive in a useful sort of way. Obviously, you could take the tool and you could use it for evil.
Right.
And is it our right to judge whether people are using this correctly or not?
Well, no, it's not even the judging. We can't. We have no control over that.
We're not police.
We're presuming that people are going to do something legitimate and good with this. It's a very, very odd situation. The idea that hypnosis is somehow this other thing that is always bad. And again, it's only a tool. And it's a damn good tool.
Exactly.
I had a brilliant point there, but since I'm, you know, closing in on 70, it's completely gone out of my mind.
How does that belief serve you, Mike?
Very, very poorly.
Okay. So bottom line is, if somebody comes in and says, oh, well, this is manipulative, when it's simply a tool and it's not being thrown at a particular situation. So if you look at a hammer and say, oh, that's manipulative, you are coming at it with a bias, either out of ignorance or you're already hypnotized.
Yeah, to believe that.
Right.
You know, Derek Balmer, one of my mentors, he used to say hypnosis, he had a whole thing about it. He said it's not a thing. When people would question manipulation, he'd say hypnosis isn't a thing. It's just a set of procedures.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're attempting to talk someone into something, you're manipulating them to take your point of view. This kind of stuff's happening all the time.
Of course, all communication can be for the purpose of manipulating somebody else's view. Right?
You just brought it back. You brought back the thing that closing in on 70, I've forgotten.
Good.
I wanted to give the example of clean language, David Grove's clean language, which Judy Reese teaches and others teach, where you're using language to elicit the unconscious metaphors that are springing up in our speech about every 6 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And if I say to you something like, you know, you say, oh, I just want, I want a better life. And I say, a better life like what? And you say, well, like a vacation. I want a life that's like a vacation. Now I start to unpack that. What kind of vacation
is that? Yeah.
Those are your two Jedi questions. And as we unpack this, you get more and more in touch with the metaphor.
Like a vacation, kind of the, like if I just get up and have my coffee and I can lie in a hammock and read a wonderful book and the kids are playing and the sun is shining. It just really perfect.
Right. Now we're unpacking. Yeah. Now, and we're unpacking a positive. Now, clean language is just a tool. I could equally use it like black magic.
Mm-hmm.
If you said to me, oh, life is so horrible, I'd say, what's horrible about it? You say, oh, I just feel like I'm being crushed by a steamroller. And I say, and what kind of steamroller is it? You say,
a
big, heavy one.
This horrible metaphor.
By unpacking the negative, I'm having a profoundly bad effect on him. It's not helping him. But does that make clean language manipulative?
Well, it could be. And it even says so right in the book that if you learn clean language, make sure that you use it in this type of way and not in this other type of way, i.e. what you just described.
Yeah.
Because it's a tool. It's a set of procedures that I guess makes it like a tool, right? I'm just using the words interchangeably.
Well, yeah. And
you can use any of this stuff for good or you can use it for evil. And it is not our place to decide which of those you are.
But we hope you're going to use
it. We hope you're good.
Because you can help a lot of people with this stuff, as we do. You know, we should back up before we go on. And let's graft in the think tank words of the day.
Right. We skipped them all together.
Well,
what
I generated these yesterday from the actual think tank. The first one is mica.
Mica?
M-I-C-A.
What is that?
Mica is the mineral that comes off in very thin sheets like silicon.
New word for me. Okay.
But let's get a definition of mica.
Mica.
For mica. Get it? For mica?
For mica. Spelled M-I-C-A.
M-I-C-E.
M-I-C-A.
Here we are. Mica. Any of the various colored or transparent...
Is mica just short for Michael C. Anthony?
No, it isn't. Uh-huh. Transparent mineral silicates crystallizing in monoclinic forms, readily separating into very thin leaves.
Okay, so immediately that just makes me think of baby steps.
Okay.
Because thin layers, little progressions, right?
Yep.
You can either attack a problem by peeling off one layer at a time.
Yes.
Or you can build up something amazing by building one layer at a time, sedimentary deposit almost.
Yeah, that's right. And when you've got very thin sheets like silicon, we're seeing like Silicon Valley, it leads to that. The idea of you can build immensely complex and powerful things with those baby steps.
Yes, you can. Absolutely.
So what about anti-aircraft?
How that's the second word?
Yeah.
Anti-aircraft.
Shooting things down. Why you shoot things down? Because it's going to do you harm. Shoot down a plane that's going to do you harm.
Yeah, and you know, I guess if you think about layers and what was the mica, the earlier word, baby steps. So anti-aircraft, I'm thinking that relates to the idea of basement people, people who want to drag you down, bad people who are not helpful in any way, shape, or form. Maybe you take baby steps towards figuring out who those are in your life and distancing yourself.
And also, yeah, it's good. Also, I'm thinking that... an anti-aircraft gun, hypnosis as manipulation is the anti-aircraft gun trying to take down the plane of hypnosis. Manipulation is...
That's true. Yeah. You're just manipulating people to try to believe
that. All I know is it's evil. All right.
So,
the last one is nasal. Now, I just think of an anti-aircraft missile flying right up someone's nose. Yeah, and that's probably not a...
That one doesn't fit for me. I'm not getting anything.
No, the whole point
instantly.
Is you've got to make it fit.
Okay, so how do we make nasal fit? Do we have to make it fit with mica and anti-aircraft?
No, but you can if you like. And what I'm thinking is that form of meditation we teach where you're breathing in nasal orifices feel cool. Then you breathe out and they feel warm. And I'm telling people who get stressed out about hypnosis, just calm down.
That makes sense. Let's go with that.
Okay. That's our story.
I'm not coming up with anything better than that right now.
Did you want to say anything else about the cards being unethical?
No, not really. I think just the idea that, all communication can be used to persuade people, to influence people, to create... that's what I wanted to say. And I was so glad you brought up Freddie Jacquin and the idea of emotions and suggestions, right?
Yeah.
So if we remember yesterday we were talking on the phone, planning this podcast out, thinking about if we could use Pareto's principle to 80-20 rule, right? The 80-20 rule of life is Pareto's law. If we could figure out what is the 80% of the benefit that comes from 20% of the tool... of hypnosis. Mm-hmm. And specifically, we're talking about conversational aspect of hypnosis here. So what is the 20% of the linguistic stuff that will give you 80% of the benefit? Well, I think that we can just boil it down and say, it's create an emotion and give a suggestion, which Freddie teaches quite often.
Right.
If you do that, you're just getting, because pretty much emotional responses are unconscious responses, right?
Absolutely. Does that make sense? They are. Absolutely.
So
they
if we can get somebody to feel an emotion and then we can offer them a suggestion that is useful in some way, and you know, on the manipulative side of the coin, people can do this all the time, right? They can manipulate you into buying something or giving up money or giving up time doing something for somebody by creating an emotion and then making a request. So it can be used for good or evil, but the 80-20 rule dictates, to me at least, that that is the simplest way to go. Now, how do you create an emotion?
Well, yeah, that's interesting. You're making me go through my personal history here, and I can think of a guy I used to know, and his whole thing was he would infuriate people on purpose, get them really mad, and then start pushing their buttons more. And, you know, like, he'd say, oh, he's hungover. I'm not hungover. Like, and just using the emotion of their anger to then get control of them, to hijack them.
Yeah. So, okay. So there are different ways to create emotion. So if you're pushing somebody's buttons, you're, I don't even know what you're going to call that. If you're just pushing something, you're hungover, you're saying to the person, they get mad.
And mocking them in front of other people. So they get mad and defensive.
Yeah. But in terms of the normal ways of, let's say, creating an emotion, you could tell a story.
Yep.
Or you can have
Freddie Jackman thing of thinking about all the people you love and who loves you.
Or you can ask somebody to imagine, right?
Yep.
So you can have them do some sort of in their mind imagination, visual imagination, auditory, kinesthetic, whatever. If you imagine being on a vacation, you're going to be in an emotional state that's different than,
imagine you're bound up with barbed wire, like in Guantanamo Bay.
Or if you were cleaning up your messy kitchen and it was not very fun and you were bored and you're really looking forward to doing something else, you're in a very different emotional state than if you start imagining what that next vacation is going to be
For sure, yeah.
And similarly, if you are listening to somebody tell an interesting story, you're going to imagine that the story is happening to you in some way to relate to it, just like we do when we're watching a movie or whatever, right? So what other ways
you generate the emotion in a movie through all these different things happening, and you get a response with the audience. I give you an example. There was that horrendously sad film just many, many years ago, I think in the 70s. It was Love Story. And the woman is dying of cancer, and they wring every bit of emotion out of this. And the horrible song. Da, da, da,
da, da, oh, yeah. Da, da,
da, da, da. Anyway, and all through the audience, just people crying all over the place. Now, they've been hypnotized.
Yes, of course.
And emotion has been created. And the suggestion is this wonderful woman is dying of cancer and she's your friend and you know her because you spend all this time with her in this film. And she's an actress. She got paid $8 million for that scene.
It's not real. None of it's real. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So when you are looking at people who are accusing you of being manipulative, or you're noticing somebody else is trying to manipulate or influence for the positive, just think about it. Where is emotion being brought in, and what suggestions or requests are being given?
Right. What is the end result of this? What this will lead to if left to its logical conclusion. Now, wait, let's talk about practicing hypnotic language, because, you know, people have got the Nuvi app and the cards, and I think people like to sort of be coached on how they can use this.
Okay, right. So we're shifting gears here now because we've got some questions over the last week about how to practice doing this hypnotic language stuff, right? And again, we're presupposing you're going to do this for helpful means, right? So whether it's to influence people to have a better life or to help your clients or whatever it is. So what is Nuvi, Mike? Let's start there, because that's something I don't know if we talked about in the podcast.
Right. Nuvi is nominalization, unspecified verb induction. It can be used as an induction, but in reality, I like what you say about it, Chris. It's training wheels.
Okay. Yeah. So let's back up a second here. First of all, it's a free course and a free mobile app that you can get. So if you want to learn how to practice this stuff, head to MikeMandelHypnosis.com/Nuvi-course.
Is Nuvi caps?
No, doesn't matter. Nuvi-course. So head on over there, and you can grab the course that is totally free and the mobile app in the App Store for Android or iPhone. The links are both there.
And because it's free, we're not advertising something. We're giving you this.
Well,
this will help you improve your hypnotic language.
We're manipulating you into having
a free offer.
A better experience with hypnosis. So a few years ago, you created this exercise called Nuvi. And it was based on the idea of connecting words to other words using... So you're connecting nominalizations to verbs that we're calling unspecified verbs, using connectors, which in Ericksonian hypnosis, people just call them linkages. So the simplest linkage would be and or and as.
And
an example
you, and
of,
if you,
yeah. An example of a nominalization could be something like
empowerment, enjoyment,
love,
happiness,
connection, fun
prestige,
could be one, right? Manipulation is one too, by the way. Not a good one, but
it's a noun you can't put in a wheelbarrow.
Right. These are all nouns, i.e. things that you can't physically reach out and touch and grab or anything like that. So we call them nouns you can't put in a wheelbarrow. Verbs would be something like learn, for example. Now, learn is, we'd call that an unspecified verb because...
Yeah, learn how? Reading a book, it's listening not, to headphones, having someone lecture you. Yeah.
Learn by doing something yourself, figuring it out, watching a video, reading a book. Yeah. So learn or discover or transform, these are all examples of unspecified verbs. And when you put them together using these connectors like and as, we start getting things like... And we'll just do this together here. So, and you can begin to find ways to transform your life in new and fun ways.
And it's a simple thing to relax and feel that enjoyment as your brain processes all of these things below the surface.
And now let's shift into maybe talking about what we're going to do later on with lunch. So let's continue on the track, but let's give it some context. So lunch. So, and you can enjoy thinking about the food that's going to be served to you in an enjoyable way, in an enjoyable, relaxed location.
And when the sunlight is shining through the windows into that wonderful restaurant, the anticipation of all of the food will be entirely appropriate for you now.
To really just taste the quality of the experience.
And a good glass of wine can make everything so much better.
That's right. So there we go. Completely off the cuff. But yeah. So point being, you're creating these never-ending sentences, right? This is something that is foundational to all conversational hypnosis. The idea that you can just talk and you can continue to connect ideas to new ideas by using linkages.
And never put a period at the end of the sentence.
Right.
Right.
So... in order to make that happen, we've got this Nuvi course. You can check it out. It's right on our website, like I said. But how can you practice this? So we thought about some ideas, right?
Well, I was originally practicing the language patterns when Derek Bommer was cementing them in my head. When I would be taking a shower, not mm-hmm. with Derek Bommer. No, there's anything wrong with it. But no, he'd give me the ideas and I'd just be showering and just talking in hypnotic language. And now it's easy to do while you're driving because everyone presumes you're on the phone. You don't look like a psycho anymore.
They just think you're on Bluetooth. That's right. Yeah. So there's all kinds of ways that you can practice. But oh yeah, now I remember why I wanted to bring this up, Mike. So Nuvi, we call it nominalization unspecified verb induction.
However,
is it, the question is, and this came up last week, is Nuvi actually an induction?
It can be an induction, but the real purpose of it is to practice language patterns.
That's it. And that's the distinction we wanted to make, is Nuvi should be considered training wheels or practice, some sort of practice tool to just generate the Ericksonian language, the conversational language, the idea of having a list. So let's say we just had somebody sitting in a chair and they're going to go into a trance in a moment. And I've got this list of nominalizations and this list of unspecified verbs.
You got some
connectives. And I'm going to connect them together. Well, is that going to cause the other person to go into trance? I'd say it could, provided that there's rapport and you have a willing subject whose intention is to go into trance.
But the intention here is not to give you a fail-safe linguistic trance induction method. The intention is to give you the means to create a language generator in your own brain so that you can do this stuff automatically. And when that happens, it is the death knell to all scripts of all kinds.
That's
because
it.
Because you just generated on the fly.
And that's, I think you just hit the nail on the head right there with how we can simplify for this for people. It is a language generator that you're looking to install in your brain. You want to be able to just talk hypnotically. Then you get to aim that language at a specific outcome that you have in mind, right? And usually in the first morning of our class, we talk about pacing and leading. So we talk about the idea of how to pace somebody's current experience and then lead them to where we want them to go. So if I want to influence you to, let's say, try out a new restaurant today, then we can talk about how soon we'll be wrapping up this podcast. And then perhaps we'll set our attention to where we're going to eat for lunch. And that we've had lunch at this particular restaurant many times before, and we have enjoyed it. But there's a new set of restaurant opportunities that we can consider. And I wonder which of those new opportunities we can really enjoy in a different way today.
Right, right.
You know, what making all
the sense. You get the point. Like you're pointing it at something and it's a practice exercise, which is great.
So you've got to take Nuvi as a tool and then you've got to employ it in the same way that you would normally do hypnotic language, which is and again, pacing and leading.
Pacing and leading. And over time, the language generator becomes automatic.
That's it.
But we need to check this because we're coming up to the 35-minute mark.
Yeah, we're...
Chris, I'm going to startle you with this because there has been a Gus Grissom update. There's been a startling development in the ongoing Virgil Grissom story. This just in from David Ferry, listening from New Iberia, Louisiana, and David writes...
Yesterday, I took a mental health day and decided not to show up at my wig-making business. Instead, I went out and rented a VHS tape of a film I wanted to see again. JFK, starring Kevin Costner. I made a bucket of popcorn with dill pickle flavoring and a ton of salt. The film was really cool up until the scene of the motorcade going through Dealey Plaza. It looked like the Zapruder film, except for one thing. When they slowed the film down, you could clearly see a man by the roadside holding an open umbrella, which was strange because it was a hot, sunny day in Dallas. Imagine my shock when the umbrella man turned to the camera and gave a thumbs up. It was Gus Grissom. Ferry went on to report, Grissom looked tanned and fit, but a little tired around the eyes. The umbrella was new and clean and had the CIA logo on it, and was clearly expensive. The weird thing is, I've seen the movie JFK before, but would swear that umbrella man, Virgil Grissom, was not in it. It must be the Mandela effect.
Here we go, Chris. Life continues to get stranger and stranger. You know, we got, you mentioned to me we got an interesting email, I think it was, from someone who had purchased something from us, and they were talking about people being stuck in trance who were inadequately trained.
Oh, no, this was not a customer at all. This was just a response on Facebook, something that we had posted. And so some woman basically went off and said, well, you know, you need proper training if you're going to be able to get someone out of trance. Implication that you're going to somehow have enough training to put someone so deep in trance that you don't have enough training to bring them out.
It's ridiculous.
It's completely ridiculous. And then she went on to, you know, are you trained practitioners? Like, just, this is the nutty thing about social media, is you hit all kinds of very great people and you hit a few just completely
unusual. Yeah, yeah.
What's the word I'm looking for? Ridiculous people. People with ridiculous views about things.
Well, remember Jeff Ronning, stage hypnotist and podcaster and a number of other things, a really smart guy. He talked in his book about stage hypnosis of he got to a high school gig. I think he actually got there. A woman came up to him, and guys, it could just as easily have been a guy, you know, came up to him and said, I'm a certified hypnotherapist. I want you to know I will be at your show tonight to help out. And
in case anybody happens to get stuck in trance,
I'll sit in the front row and I'll observe carefully. If you need me to come up on stage during the show, I will work with people or even take them into another room to work with them individually after your show, like if anything's gone wrong.
Yeah.
And Ronning made exactly the right decision in my books.
That's it.
Show's canceled.
Yep.
Why put yourself through that nonsense?
Exactly. Yep. So you're going to, I think the fine point to remember here is you're going to meet ridiculous people in all sorts of places and contexts. And just don't accept it. Just fire them from your life. There's no need to engage with ridiculousness, right?
Well, Chris, we're at
it's our ridiculousness.
We're at the 40-minute mark. So why don't you give us today's empowering questions?
All right. Here is the empowering question for episode 127. Ask yourself, since we are so close to the middle of 2019, what will I do to ensure that this is a productive year? What will I begin to do today to make this one of my finest years?
Nice one. There's still time to get it all nailed and have a great year. I can't believe the date already. It's insane how fast it's going. I want to give you a meta five today, Chris, which is the desk trick. It's kind of interesting. Back when I was a kid and then into the 1970s, one of my favorite TV shows was based on the Neil Simon play, The Odd Couple. Then it became a movie with Jack Lemmon and Walter Matthau. And then it became a TV show with Tony Randall and Jack Klugman. And it's universally agreed that they played the roles better than the originals. The reason it was so good was they play these dysfunctional roommates, both divorced, trying to live together and still be friends without driving each other crazy. They play their Enneagram types perfectly. Tony Randall plays an Enneagram 1 who is rigid, controlling, and goes to the worst of four under stress and becomes a whiny suck. Jack Klugman plays a 7 who is just an absolute slob, makes a mess everywhere, doesn't see it, and under stress he goes to the worst of 1. He becomes very rigid and controlling. So they actually meet at 1. But this is one of my parents' favorite TV shows. They loved it. So can you imagine when in 1981 I had a gig in Philadelphia on a talk show, how amazed I was that I was sharing a dressing room with Tony Randall, who is one of my heroes as an actor. He was a wonderful man, very nice, very friendly to me, and I did a crap job on that show. I could hardly get anything to work. But here's what I remember most about it. My parents would have just been blown away that I met him. But one of the episodes of The Odd Couple that amazed me was they were arguing about who was the fittest. The kind of argument you don't get into because everybody knows you are. So anyway, Tony Randall wanted to prove he was the fittest as Felix Unger. He stood in front of Oscar's desk and just jumped straight up in the air and landed on his desk with both feet staring at him. The audience went wild. It looked so bizarre. So when I shared the dressing room with him, I said, you know, there's a thing you did in The Odd Couple, Mr. Randall, that just blew me away. And he said, the thing with the desk, he knew what it was. And I said, yeah. And he explained to me, this is something they did in Victorian days. They used to jump up onto fireplaces, really fit guys, as a contest, I guess when they're all drinking. Mm-hmm. And he said, the way you do it with the desk, and you could so do this, he said, everyone tries to jump onto it with both feet, catch their toes and fall. He said, instead, you jump straight up in the air as high as you can. And when you're at the apex of your jump, all you do is shift your feet forward in the air and you land on the desk. I've never had the nerve to try it.
Oh, everybody, I hope you enjoyed this podcast. This has been episode 127 of the Brain Software Podcast with Mike Mandel.
And come what may, we'll be back.
And I'm Chris Thompson. And we'll see you again in the next episode. Make sure you check out our website, MikeMandelHypnosis.com. Get the Brain Software ebook right there on the homepage. And check out the events page. Come to Toronto. Study with us.
Thanks again.
And good night.
Oh, Danny boy. Oh, Danny boy. Oh, Danny boy. Oh, Danny boy. Oh, Danny, Danny boy. Oh, Danny boy. Oh, Danny, Danny, Danny boy. Oh, Danny boy, oh, Danny boy, oh, Danny boy. And come what may, and come what may, and come what may. And come what may, oh, Danny, Danny boy. And come what may, and come what may, oh, Danny boy, oh, Danny.
I don't even know where this is going. Oh, that's fantastic.
Okay, let's go get lunch.